Thank you everyone here for inviting me to speak. My name's Monty, and I'm going to talk about our largest, most visible, yet I believe most overlooked organ, our skin. My best friend is a surgeon, and he likes to tease me and calls skin the wrapping paper that covers the presents. And today I want to completely dispel that myth. So I typed junior doctor into Google Images, and that was the first thing that came up. And I'm sure that for all of us who work in healthcare, it might feel like that sometimes, but it is also hugely rewarding. And I've spent a lot of time on vascular surgery wards, care of the elderly wards, and spent a lot of time with tissue viability nurses, podiatrists, and a lot of other healthcare professionals who work with wound healing, and I'm constantly in awe. Wounds are complex, but they are so rewarding to deal with and manage and to heal, and it makes such a difference to the patient. And yes, as Helen said, I have written a book about the skin. It's not a textbook, it's a popular science book, looking at the skin in all of its physical, but also its psychological, social, even philosophical glory. It was published a few months ago. The paperback came out last week. It was a Sunday Times Book of the Year and a Radio 4 Book of the Week as well. And I also want to talk a bit about new skin research into wound healing. And it took a bit of effort to try and get medical photography to sort out photos from some of the patients on my ward at the moment. So handily, my parent dog Hector managed to scrape his belly on a bit of barbed wire fence about a month ago. And with their intervention of just making sure that he didn't lick it, his favorite delicacy is horse manure. Within a couple of weeks, it's almost completely healed. And I just want to, wound healing is absolutely magical. And I want to look a bit into some new, really interesting research on that at the end. I've got lots of slides about that, and I'll almost certainly run over because I got very excited about some of the new studies. I'm really interested in the immunology of skin, but also skin cancer. And I did a trip, went on a medical trip to Tanzania to look at infectious skin diseases, but also albinism, which is a condition where a genetic mutation means that people with albinism don't produce any melanin, which is our protective pigment against sun damage. And people with albinism have a very high risk of getting skin cancer and consequently have a much reduced life expectancy. In one of my clinics, I saw a young Tanzanian man called Danny who came into the clinic. He was a stooped over, head bowed, wasn't really talking at all. And with one of the Tanzanian dermatologists who was in the clinic with me, we would scan his skin looking for precancerous lesions or cancers which we would blast away with liquid nitrogen or refer to surgery and cut them out. But the more I spoke to Danny, the more I realized that he wasn't interested in his increased risk of skin cancer and his potentially reduced life expectancy and sun protection and things like that. And as I spoke to him, I realized that the thing that worried him the most was his fellow man, his fellow people. Because in that area of Africa, Malawi and Tanzania, over the last 20 years, has been the trade of body parts of people with albinism, a myth perpetrated by witch doctors saying that the crushed bones of people with albinism can cure anything from the common cold to AIDS. And I was told by one of the dermatologists there that for every person with albinism you see in that part of Tanzania, another has been sold and killed, often by close family members. That was a witch doctor I met, might not have had any involvement with it, but there's still a lot of those practices in that area of rural Tanzania. And at that point, I realized that skin isn't just a physical organ, it's also a deeply psychological and social organ, we can often feel confined and defined by our skin. So that's what got me interested in the skin, and we'll have a look at all of those different aspects in a bit. So our skin is our largest organ, as I'm sure most of us know. The average person carries a dachshund's worth of skin on us. I have a lot of sort of animal-related facts, mainly dog-related facts. It's an incredible barrier. It regulates our body temperature. Most of our vitamins we get through diet, but isn't it incredible that vitamin D, which is more of a hormone, we get it through it being cut up and destroyed by rays from our nearest star on the surface of our skin, and that's how we get most of our vitamin D. It's a literally attractive organ, not necessarily in the way it looks, but in the smell it makes in terms of finding a mate. The skin microbiome is really interesting, and we'll also look at the sense of touch and skin's role in communication. So the epidermis is the top layer of skin. It's about a millimeter thick, so if you've got a sheet of paper with you, it's about that thick, yet it carries almost all of the skin's barrier functions. It's absolutely incredible. It's incredibly hard. So stem cells in the basal layer produce these cells, and they slowly make their way through their roughly month-long 30-day life to the surface, and they make the ultimate sacrifice for us. They, in forming an incredibly hard interlocking scales on the surface in the stratum corneum, they essentially sacrifice themselves, expelling their nucleus, the cell's brain, so that they are essentially a thick layer of keratin, and keratin is the hard protein we see in our nails and our hair, and also in the claws and horns of the animal kingdom. So keras in Greek means horn, and from which we get rhinoceros. Great. And in the late 1800s, Lord Kelvin, some of you might know by the Kelvin scale, he was a physicist and mathematician who discovered the number of absolute zero. Was a bit of a wild card. He came up with lots of different ideas and postulations, and one of these was he wants to work out what would be the perfect foam, and that would be essentially the size, the shape of an object that if they were going to fit into a box of the same size, that if they were put together, they had the smallest surface area between them. And no one was really interested in that theory that he came up with. His contemporaries even called him frothy, and that was almost completely ignored for about almost 150 years until 2016, when some researchers at Imperial College London and a team in Japan discovered that while our keratinocytes, our skin cells, rise to the surface and flake off, so they're constantly on the move, they adopt this incredibly unique shape so that even though the barrier is always moving, it's waterproof, it's incredibly hard, and it's unbelievably interlocking. So in some ways, our skin is the perfect cappuccino. Brilliant. Our epidermis is also very dynamic. If you rub it repeatedly, it thickens, causing calluses from builders to rowers to electric guitar players to climbers. The skin recognizes that there's a constant shearing force and it thickens. There are some genetic, very rare genetic conditions where this goes awry. Edward Lambert was a gentleman in the 1800s who had a condition called ichthyosis hystrix. Hystrix is the Greek for porcupine, and he was literally known as the porcupine man because his keratinocytes would proliferate so quickly he essentially had scales across all of his body, but not over his face and hands and feet. And he sadly made his money for someone else going around Europe as part of a traveling circus. But actually, a third of us have a hyperkeratotic condition, called keratosis pilaris, commonly known as chicken skin. And the sort of rubbing sort of the bumpy areas often across the backs of our arms and our legs is because the keratinocytes are sometimes proliferating too much and they block hair follicles, causing that rough chicken skin appearance. also some recent research on the epidermis found that midnight snacks could potentially cause sunburns. This was only found in mice, so don't worry, it hasn't been done on humans yet. But it just shows you that the skin, we know that our body has a circadian rhythm, a body clock, but our skin also has its own body clock. And in the morning, starting at 7 a.m., peaking throughout the morning, the genes that essentially repair our DNA when it's damaged by the sun are only normally active in the morning and early afternoon. But if you eat later at night, say eat at midnight, it tricks your body into thinking that it's dinner time, it's 7 p.m. So it pushes your skin's body clock back, and so you're actually unprotected in the morning against the sun's rays. There's also some recent studies into eczema, showing that eczema is not actually just an inflammatory or an allergic condition. It's actually partly to do with a genetic mutation in the skin. So it's the barrier dysfunction that causes the skin to break down, water to go out, and allergens and bacteria to come in. So actually eczema, in many ways, isn't inside out, or an outside-in condition rather than an inside-out. Below the epidermis, and most of the thickness of the skin, is the dermis. It's the skin city. Most of the cells that have all of the different diverse functions of the skin live in the dermis. We've got a standing immune army. We've got lots of blood vessels, enough to bridge Europe and Africa across the Strait of Gibraltar in each of us. And they vasodilate or constrict to keep heat in or out. My favorite thing about the dermis, or the favorite thing it produces, is sweat. I like to think of it as the elixir of life, or the elixir of survival. So with our sort of 4 million sweat glands, our body can pump out literally millions of, or literally sort of liters of sweat per day, and we know that it cools us down when it evaporates. And if you ask a group of people, what's the physical aspect of humans that differentiates us from apes, monkeys, animals, people would say a large brain, a large cerebral cortex, or opposable thumbs. But actually, if we didn't have this amount of 4 million sweat glands, the naked human could never have traveled across long distances, across Africa and out across the world without our very large brain overheating. But why do our palms and our feet start to clam up when we're about to go into a room for an interview, even if it's really chilly inside? And that cold sweat, recent research has shown that actually it's counterintuitive, but sweat increases the grip on our hands. So in a fight or flight situation, we actually have more of a chance of grabbing hold of a weapon or scarfing up a tree if we're faced with a lion or a particularly nasty interviewer. And I think the coolest aspect of sweat, mainly from our apocrine sweat glands, so from in our armpits and around our genital regions, is that they might have a very important role in matchmaking. So they produce what's sort of known as pheromones, or our odor print. And studies have shown that the smell of a loved one brings back happy memories, can reduce stress and cortisol levels. And one of my favorite studies is the sweaty t-shirt study, where a group of men were told to wear a t-shirt for a week and not to wash at all. Then each man would put the t-shirt into a box, and a group of women would then sniff each of the boxes and rank them in terms of strength, attractiveness, even sexiness was on the list of things to choose from. And really interestingly, women were more attracted to the sweat, the smell of men who had different genes to them, which would make sense from an incest avoiding perspective. But it was specifically the MHC genes, which make up our immune system. And essentially, we don't have enough space essentially in our genes to recognize every single potential pathogen that could enter our body, but that can actually be spread amongst the herd of humans. So if no matter what pandemic of any kind of molecule happens in the future, even if no vaccine's made, because we have intermixed enough, there will always be people who will be able to survive it. So actually our skin-nose connection might just be saving humanity. And the hypodermis or subcutaneous tissue, there's a bit of debate as to whether it's skin or not. I'm going to claim that it is because there are some cool things about it that we'll look at a bit later that most people don't think it is. Is essentially the fatty fibrous tissue and fascia below the skin. One of the interesting aspects of the hypodermis is it explains why the sort of the quirk as to why roughly 90% of women get cellulite, that cottage cheesy companion, but only 10% of men get it. And that's due to the architecture of the fibrous bands that link the sort of muscle to the skin. And for some reason, in women, they're arranged in parallel, like the sort of columns of a Greek temple. So the fat can eventually sort of push up and protrude through it. Whereas in men, they're more like the sort of pointed Gothic arches, sort of crisscrossed, which tends to keep the fat more locked in. And the skin's microbiome is also really fascinating. And there are potentially new studies to show that if we put good bacteria on our skin, that might alleviate common conditions such as eczema and psoriasis and things like that. So you won't have to be worrying about steroids. This is actually quite far away from lunch, so I think I can talk about this. On roughly half of us on our skin lies the Demodex mite. They usually clamber onto the hair follicles of our eyebrows and swim around the oily areas of our face. And the men usually come out at night, swimming with their eight little stumpy legs around the oil of our face at about 16 millimeters an hour, looking for a mate. But the trouble is the females tend to burrow quite deep and only occasionally come out of our pores to try and find the males. But seeing that they only have 2 weeks to live, there is a certain sense of urgency. And also the other issue is that they're fantastic at clearing away dead skin and debris from our faces, but they lack a back passage. So they eventually get larger and larger and larger throughout their 2 week life until they eventually explode. And recent research has showed that they have a microbiome of their own, and the bacteria inside their microbiome can sometimes react with our skin when they explode. And that might be one of the causes of rosacea around the sort of the nose and the oily areas of the face. An interesting thing about skin microbiome research is that skin microbes might also cure body odor. So there was a 2017 study in San Diego that had two twins. One twin, for some reason, smelt pretty ponky, and the other one didn't smell at all, really. And what they did is they got the twin who didn't smell at all not to wash for a week, and they scraped some of the skin and swabbed some of the skin from the non-smelly twin onto the whiffy one, into his armpits, and the effect lasted for a year. He didn't smell at all. So it's actually the way the bacteria eat and produce the molecules in our skin is what actually causes the BO. Touch is our first sense to develop, and it is incredible. It's really underrated. It's in a sort of era where we're more in touch with our touch screens rather than giving a friend a pat on the back or holding the hand of a patient or relative. It's hugely important. So basketball teams that have their players touch each other more often, or fist bumping, are shown to be more successful than ones that don't. And it might be that I want to do a study in tennis. I'm assuming that's probably a similar effect. Waiters or waitresses who tap the shoulders of their customers are likely to get a 20% tip increase. And people who are interviewers who are holding a sort of a thick clipboard are more likely to hire someone. Also, kangaroo care is incredibly important at the beginning of life. It was discovered when a Colombian doctor in a neonatal ward, they had a, in the 1970s, they had a 70% mortality rate. And just to increase heat of the neonates, he got them to lie on the skin of their mothers or fathers sometimes after birth. And that reduced the mortality rate from 70 down to 10%. And so that's hugely important at the start of life, but also at the end of life. Studies show that touching with patients, with elderly patients with dementia, improves cognitive function and mood. Studies showing massage is almost three times as effective as just a social visit for people with dementia. Skin is also exquisitely psychological. Charles Darwin said that blushing was the most peculiar and most human of emotions. The fact that we can just think about something and the whole way our body looks changes to someone. But studies have actually shown that blushing has, if you like me have erythrophobia, fear of blushing, it actually has a really positive social effect. Studies show that people who blush or have a higher tendency to blush are more likely to be accepted by the social group. And the theory behind that is that if you blush, you show that you recognize that some kind of social norm has been broken, either by someone else or more often maybe you, and it shows that you're not shameless. On a trip to East Africa I made as well with a Tanzanian dermatologist, he took me to a Maasai village on the corner of the Serengeti, because they had a case of a young boy, 14-year-old boy, with a really strange skin condition that they couldn't explain. So we went into the house, we saw the boy, we examined him. I had no idea what was going on. He had a very strange patterned blistering rash across his face and one side of his neck. So I looked at the dermatologist and he had no clue as well. But when we started to talk to the villagers, we realized that this boy was about to go on walkabout. Essentially, it was a sort of a coming of age practice where he would go out into the bush, into the savannah, sort of fend for himself, sort of 6 months to a year. And he really didn't want to do this. So what he did is he secretly went out into the bush, he got a plant, and it was known that the sap was rubbed against the skin, it would cause phytodermatitis, so the skin would blister. And he was secretly causing blisters on his face to mimic some kind of disease. And this is known as dermatitis artifacta, creating the mind manifesting itself on the skin. And it's actually very, very common in the UK as well, often with sort of suction cups and things like that with children. The dermatologist called it Monday syndrome, because often children happen to get it on Monday before school starts as well. It just shows you how important the mind and the skin are. Skin is also very social. My family's from New Zealand, and I've been a number of times, and I've been able to interview some people who have the tamoko, which is the Maori tattoo, which is incredibly beautiful and exquisite and very complex. Your birth status is drawn on your forehead. Your wealth is sort of along your jawline, and then some other aspects of where you stand in the hierarchy are on your chin. And one of the Maori people at one of the centres I went to said that British people would absolutely hate it, because it's like having your CV and your bank balance sort of plastered on your forehead. And when the British arrived in New Zealand, instead of signing signatures on pieces of paper, local chiefs would draw their tamoko tattoo, and it's just the most incredible way of our skin, I think, of our skin communicating to other people. But also, skin has brought out the worst in humanity as well. Across the world, lots of skin conditions also have animalistic names. And in the 1930s, the Nazis created a fake skin condition called the Judenkratzer, which is the Jewish itch. And they used that, and you can see the timeline of them creating something called the Jewish itch, to comparing Jews to rats, and then in their propaganda films, talking about the extermination of rats and vermin. I love this phrase. It's from a First Peoples American tribe, the Navajo, who say that the their fingerprints hold them to the sky and their toe prints hold them to the ground, so they know exactly where they are in the world. Skin often grounds us in where we are. And often religions are about moving across space and also sensation. And skin has a huge role, even in how much skin we show to other people, plays a huge role in religions and cultures. In the Old Testament and the New Testament, people with leprosy, it was a sort of representation of inner spiritual sin manifesting itself on the skin, and these people had to live out in camps outside of the main city. And the first person that Jesus healed in the New Testament was a man with leprosy. So skin plays a huge role in all the major world religions. Even language that we use today has been influenced by our skin. You can call someone callous, tactless, or say that I'm touch. Someone who's tactless literally doesn't have touch. And also there are lots of metaphors about our boundary, being thick-skinned or getting under one's skin. Even makeup, one of the big French philosophers, Foucault, said that makeup's a very interesting word, because in creating our skin, the way we present it to other people is, in a way, creating oneself. There's also a really interesting paradox about the skin. Often we have phrases saying that the skin's thin, light, doesn't really mean anything, like skin deep. But also there are loads of phrases in languages all across the world where you can interchange the word self or life with skin. So saving one's skin, or in French, vouloir la peau, taking one's life, or taking one's skin. And yeah, it's still not that close to lunch, so I can talk about Burke's skin pocketbook. William Burke was one of the two Williamses, Burke and Hare, who in the 1800s in Edinburgh, they went around murdering 16 people to supply the anatomy department at the Edinburgh Medical School. And I think the head of anatomy might have been complicit in this as well. And when he was, when William Burke, one of the murderers, was hanged in the center of Edinburgh in front of about 25,000 people, after he died, his skin was flayed and tanned and made into the cover of a book listing all of his crimes, which is probably the most literal example of our skin being a book, or at least the cover. And that's called, for those of you who want to know, it's called anthropodermic bibliopagy, which is the binding of books in human skin. But I'll move on. sort of bridging skin to wound healing is the way in which people, as we do in tattooing, can be a way of communicating with other people. So the Hamar tribe in southern Ethiopia have a coming of age ceremony for young men, where the young man has to run across a line of bulls. And while he does that, his sisters take part in a ceremony where they say that they will look after their brothers and fend off any intruders. And other villagers ceremonially whip their backs, and causing these large hypertrophic scars. But the women say that they take these scars with honor, because they're a sign of their love for their brother, and but also it's a duty for the brothers to look after their family and their sisters. And the Kaningara people, next to one of the large rivers in Borneo, a large number of the people worship the crocodile, because the river is full of them. And in one of the male coming of age ceremonies, where they have to stay in one of the huts for about 5 to 6 months, they have a tattoos made out of essentially lots of small cuts in the skin. And when the cut's made, they put some of the dirty river water into the cut so that the wound heals slower, creating a sort of a keloid effect. And this produces a beautiful pattern that is meant to represent the scales of a crocodile. And so I won't go into the details of the beauty of wound healing, and as a lot of you know, that it's not, the process of wound healing isn't simply a four movement symphony. It's a lot more complex than that. It can be split into different phases as well, like the early and cellular, but it's incredibly complex and beautiful. So just briefly, within seconds to minutes, you get, say if you have a paper cut, your blood vessels constrict and the platelet plug is formed, fibrin mesh is made, and that and the clotting cascades form a temporary plug through which cells can crawl over. And then after about an hour, neutrophils and other immune cells race to the wound, and lots of the cells have a very important role of destroying potential pathogens, but also clearing up damage and remodeling the skin. Later on, in the proliferative phase, keratinocytes rush to cover the surface of our skin to make that sort of all-important moist area for healing, and they initiate contact inhibition when the two sides meet, and also fibroblasts produce meshes of collagen, but that's mainly after laying down ground substance and granulation tissue. And then over a much longer period, the wound begins to mature, the type of collagen begins to change, and there's new different types of cross-linking, and cells that are no longer needed are destroyed. But yeah, it's not exactly that linear, and it's a lot more complicated than that. So I'm going to briefly, I don't know how much time I've got, I'm going to look at a few new studies into how skin and skin research is influencing wound healing. And that quote isn't exactly true about healing is not a science, but the intuitive art of wooing nature. But a lot of new research with wound healing is trying to better the natural processes that occur in wound healing when it all goes well. So I'll use a metaphor of in a disaster. When you have, say, a building collapse or similar disaster, you have lots of different types of people. You have people who are at the scene, you have police, fire brigade, special forces sometimes, soldiers if necessary, and you have builders. And the resident cells of the skin, all of these different roles. So as I've mentioned before, keratinocytes are incredibly hard and powerful, but they're also very dynamic. And an interesting 2017 study finds that even after a small wound has completely healed, the keratinocytes in the skin remember the first wound and they can heal. As long as thick scar tissue hasn't formed, the skin keratinocytes remember in their stem cells the previous wound and are able to proliferate quicker the next time there's been a wound. Fibroblasts are responsible for producing collagen and elastin. They're the sort of builder cells of the skin. And there are lots, not all fibroblasts are the same. And most fibroblasts we think about are the engrailed positive fibroblasts. And these are the ones that produce lots and lots of collagen and contribute to scar formation. The studies have shown that if these are knocked out in animal studies, that scar formation, sometimes there's not even any scar formation, but healing is slower. And also studies show that in humans, in the embryo, in the early stage of the embryo, don't scar at all. And that's because these cells aren't present. So this is more relevant for wound healing in reducing scar formation. But there might be a use of reducing these types of cell in trying to get rid of scars or hypertrophic or keloid scars. Myofibroblasts are essentially like the builder, sort of muscular builder cells, and they're largely made out of a smooth muscle-like substance, and they contract both sides of the wound together, align it, and also produce lots of aspects of the extracellular matrix. Another really groundbreaking study in 2017 found that in wounds in mice, when new hair follicles are made around a wound, underneath the hair follicles, there is a synthesis of new fat cells where myofibroblasts turn, completely change into a different cell type, into fat cells. And this has only previously been shown in fish and amphibians. And that is mediated by something called BMP. So so that potentially if BMP is injected into hypertrophic, into keloid scars, that might potentially convert fibroblasts into fat cells and reduce scar formation. But it is a lot more complicated than that, because it is also the concentration and the timing of these molecules is vital to wound healing. But that was a really interesting discovery. So earlier on, I claimed the hypodermis, the fascia, as part of the skin, which it's not really, but this is why I want to claim it as skin. An amazing study a few months ago discovered that in where there's a wound that goes beneath the dermis, actually a huge amount of the healing doesn't come from the skin or the dermis. It comes from a preformed fascia plug. So if you all gently pinch your skin at the moment and you lift it up and you move it around, the only reason we can pinch our skin and move it around is because of this gelatinous layer of fascia that's underneath our skin. But even after wounding, very quickly, a large amount of this fascia comes up into the wound to plug it, and it contains a large number of these engrail-positive fibroblasts. And it also contains blood vessels and nerves. And this discovery might explain why keloids tend to occur at places over where there's lots of fascia, and also why scars or large keloid scars can be quite sore to touch because of the amount of nerves in them as well. And this is really cool as well. We've known for a long time that areas of skin that have poor nerve supply don't heal very well. There are probably lots of reasons behind this, but a study in 2018 discovered that nerve cells, or at least the cells, the glial cells that cover nerves, in the process of wound healing, they move from the nerve, go up into the surface of the wound, and actually tell the keratinocytes, tell the fibroblasts to convert into myofibroblasts to contract the wound together, which is just one of the many, many ways in which different cells communicate with each other. And immune cells are also incredibly important. So neutrophils, after about an hour, they come in and destroy bacteria. Macrophages, big eaters, they eat bacteria, and then the type of macrophage switches to a more from a damaging type of macrophage to a wound healing type of macrophage is when the sort of the proliferative phase starts to begin. Brilliant. And another. I've got quite a few slides over these cells, so I'll just look at some highlights. One cell I spent about a year working in a lab in Oxford is the innate lymphoid cell. And these are really cool. They were only discovered about 10 years ago, and they play a role between the innate, the immediate immune system, and the memory adaptive immune system. And one of the studies I did, which sadly hasn't been published yet, so I'm not allowed to talk about the findings, found that actually in sterile wounds, in sterile damage, it causes a very different pathway and a very different type of molecules that are more likely to bring about wound healing. Whereas if there are infectious agents, inflammatory agents, we're more likely to have a red, raw, inflammatory response. Brilliant. The skin microbiome is also incredibly interesting, and the microbiome over wounds might be really important in the future. Even when wounds are healed, the microbiome is distinct over that wound area. And different types of wounds have different microbes in them. So, for example, burns have thermophiles, bacteria that love heat, basically, who live there even after the burns have healed. And there are some potential, I'm just going to go over some of these slides, ways in which we can use the microbiome in wounds to heal them, but also to monitor them. So studies have shown that different strains of Staph aureus in wounds are associated with slower wound healing. And also a very interesting study using a very complex mathematical model. It was this one here. Yes, this one here, actually. Found that the rate of change of populations of microbes in the wound is related to the speed at which the wound heals. So if the microbe population is changing very slowly, then the wound is actually probably going to take a very long time to heal. So that could be really important in future wound healing research. and potentially probiotics. There are lots of good bacteria that are good for skin healing in small wounds. Maybe this could play a part in chronic wounds. I've got to remember that putting a live bacteria into a wound needs a lot of research before we actually start doing that. There are also very cool bacteria that eat bad bacteria, like eat things like Pseudomonas, which are going through some trials at the moment. Brilliant. How much time do I have left? Is it brilliant? Okay, so I'm just going to go to my last case, which I think is really interesting. In 2015, and it shows you why skin is a beautiful lab for future research, a 7-year-old Syrian migrant in Germany has something called junctional epidermolysis bullosa, which is where he genetically lacks laminin, which is essentially one of the things that links our epidermis to our dermis. So imagine if every time you knocked your knee on a table, or you turned a door latch, or you touched anything and brushed it, the skin came off and you formed a blister. And this boy had blisters over that. All of that red was the blisters. And he had loads of chronic infections. He was losing loads of fluid. And he was going to be made palliative at the age of seven. But a revolutionary maverick researcher in the University of Modena in Italy took him on. Took a bit of skin from his healthy skin that sort of clung to his thigh, put it into the lab, infected it with a retrovirus that had the correct gene the corrected gene, and then grew 9 square feet of his skin in the lab. And after two operations, his skin was cured and didn't come off. And 4 years later, the basal cells in his epidermis had continued to form new stem cells. So that's really exciting and shows skin at the forefront of stem cell research and gene therapy. So it's why I love the skin. And yeah, so hopefully from this talk, you've seen that you will see the seemingly mundane, the seemingly obvious, and fall in love with it. So thank you very much.